try to speak Greek, but then told there are no Greeks. Okay, well, that lets me off the hook. I don't have to speak Greek. this is your second session of School of American Law, right? What was the first session?
Introduction.
Okay. Because they don't always go. Introduction's not always first.
Actually, it wasn't.
Oh, okay. Sometimes introduction comes last. And that's the problem with bringing professors from America. We come when we can get here. So this session is managing and licensing intellectual property. In a minute we'll get a little bit more about who I am. But let's talk a little bit about sort of what we're here to talk about first. Historically, I know one of the sessions in School of American Law, at least usually, sometimes sessions swap in and swap out depending on availability of professor. Thank you. Is sort of overview of intellectual property law, right? This is not that. We'll talk a little bit about intellectual properties for half an hour or something later on today, just to make sure we're all on the same page. But for the most part, I'm assuming that you folks have some knowledge of intellectual property, what a copyright is, what a trademark is, what a service mark is, and that sort of thing. So this course then is about how to manage an intellectual property portfolio, and most important, how to extract value from a portfolio. Because I have found over all of my years in practice, one of the things that is most problematic for lawyers is we're very expensive people, right? As compared to other people who work, who are service providers to our clients, or who work in-house for the same company we work for, we're paid very well, right? And we are always looked at on the balance sheet as a cost center. And that is a problem, right? Because when somebody says, gee, we need to save some money, we need to cut costs, who's the first person they look at? They look at the expensive lawyer, right? So one of the things that I found was helpful for my career, and I'd like to, at the end of tomorrow, come out with you thinking might be helpful for your career, is finding a way to associate with your name a revenue line on the balance sheet. Right? If you can show that, hey, I'm generating this much money for the company, you're less likely to get fired when it's time to lay people off. So a very practical approach in this class. This class is not a lecture class. We're going to be talking, I hope. So I hope you're at least comfortable trying in English. And if you don't talk by early afternoon tomorrow, we're going to be struggling for, what are we going to talk about? So that's basically the overview of the course. Now let's talk about this Prezi today is not full of content, but it helps me to keep my my bearings and my mind with what I'm intending to speak about next. So my name is Joe Bogdan. I've been practicing law for over 30 years. I started out in big law firms in Southern California in the United States for more than 10 years. I practiced in big law firms. And I started out as a lawyer who wanted to do technology law and entertainment law. So actually another thing about this course is when most people think about intellectual property, they think about patents. And patents are important, but patents aren't necessarily where I come from in my career. I'm a soft intellectual property guy, although, a license is a license is a license, right? If you're licensing a copyright, you can, with modifications, take that license agreement and make it applicable to patents. So, interestingly, I had always wanted to do entertainment law and technology law, and I started doing that right out of law school. I was lucky enough to start practicing in those two areas. And it was fine, but then the internet happened, which, you know, I'm old enough that I was practicing law before the internet was a thing. And then when it happened, entertainment and technology came together. And clients were saying, who can speak both languages? Who can speak technology and who can speak entertainment? And there weren't very many of us. And I was able to say that I could, and I was able to. And that's pretty much how my career was made, because there was a great demand for lawyers who could speak to the issue of presenting content through new technologies, primarily the internet at that time. And so, in fact, one of the first projects I was able to do is, and it's kind of a little bit of fun, so I'll show it to you in a second. I had the good fortune to be able to do the legal work for the very first music video downloadable on the internet in 1993. And now, of course, there's nothing. Who downloads content, right? Does anybody download it anymore? No, you stream it, right? And at the time, there was no streaming because the technology just wasn't there. So it had to be downloaded. And the download was about like a 3-minute video, and the download took probably more than a few hours. And at the end of the download, you had a resident copy of the video on your computer, and you could watch it as many times as you want. So just for fun, there's no real content in this, but this will show you the very first music video downloadable over the internet. Cool.
Wow. Good.
We gotta turn it up a little.
That's how you do something.
So, oftentimes at this point, you know, what year is it? 2019. People don't even know who this band is, but they're still out there. They're still touring. Study to start this class off. I heard people say Megadeth, and some like approvingly so, which is great because I'm a metal fan myself. Who did not know who Megadeth is? Does anybody not know who they are? Okay, fair enough. Probably more than just a couple of you. But it's a band that, a more famous band in the genre is Metallica. The guy with the red hair was in Metallica, got kicked out, started this band. They've been around since the early 1980s. And at the time, the music industry was very protective of its content. It still is, but even more so then. So let's talk about how one would license this. Right now, we're all consuming this content by way of a license. In fact, I'm probably breaching the license by displaying it publicly. But we're getting it by way of a license, and the music industry is very concerned with their rights and not losing ownership on it. So, before one could consume content in this manner, typically we weren't talking about entertainment content, we were talking about software going to consumers by way of a license. And before the internet, for anybody, nobody looks bold enough, but maybe you know, or maybe you can venture a guess. Before we had the agreements that one could just click I accept on, when a consumer would access intellectual property, usually software, it would be by way of a disk that you would put into your computer, and it would download the software from the disk onto your computer. They still have those. In fact, I have a client that sells $18 million a year worth of those disks. I don't know who's buying them, but. So how would the license come to exist in that scenario where I have a disk that I put into my computer in order to get a copy of the intellectual property that I want, namely the software? How is it that the licensor and the licensee come to have a contract in that instance? Anyone? You want to speak, I can tell.
So I think it's the copyright. Right?
It's the copyright, correct?
That regulates this between the seller and buyer.
Right, and somehow the seller has to license the copyright to the buyer. So what's the mechanism through which that agreement comes to exist? Anybody know? It's a license, yes. And how is it that, and if I'm the licensee, how do I know what the terms of that license are?
By putting it down in writing?
In writing, correct. But if it's a, so let's say it's a mass-produced software. I just went to the shop. You would have to go to the store. You would buy a cardboard box with the disc in it, take the box home, open the box, put the disk in the computer and get the software. So yes, in a writing, but it's not like I'm actually talking to Bill Gates from Microsoft and he says, here's a license agreement and I sign it.
But the moment you buy it, you accept it.
And how? I mean, says who? You're on the right track.
Says the law, says the practice, says, the license.
Seller. Says the seller, right? Yeah. Okay. So
why did you accept that agreement?
Okay. Fair enough. Actually, the mechanics of the way it would work is when you would go to the store and buy it, it would be in a cardboard box about this big, even though the disc was only this big, and on the back of the box they would take a copy of a license agreement, a paper printed copy. And then they would shrink wrap the box with the paper copy of the license on it so that the license was visible to the consumer through the shrink wrap. And the first thing the license said is, when you tear open the cellophane, you are agreeing to become bound to the license, right? And that was called a shrink wrap license because it was shrink wrapped with the box, okay? So, and what the law said, both in statute in the United States and by case law, is that the act of ripping the cellophane, when the terms are visible to you, you can see, if you rip the cellophane, you agree to the license, that made it binding. And so the ripping of the shrink wrap replaced the signature on the piece of paper. Fair enough. So now, we come all the way up to 1993, and I'm going to get rid of Megadeth behind me. What I do with my clicker?
He's there.
Ah, thank you. We get all the way up to 1993, and there's no more box, right? There's only the internet, and today on the internet, I mean, how many of you have clicked I accept, right?
Without reading.
Yeah, without reading. How many of you have ever read the license? Nobody? Not even for fun?
No. Yeah, for fun, I read this before.
This one, yeah, okay. Oh, that's what, that's logo term? Which one is that? Facebook? Yeah, Facebook. And so now that's commonplace. right? I mean, I accept on this computer here this morning, accessing my software from the United States here in Greece. So that's today, right? The box is there, you click I accept, and you have agreed to some license term that maybe you're forced to read, maybe you're not forced to read, but it's there somewhere, usually, if you want to access it. But in 1993, 03/13, 25 years ago, that wasn't commonplace. So the situation we were in 1993 was, how do we deliver this content to the consumer by way of a license agreement, because the music industry is very concerned with its copyrights, and in a way that's binding, right? Because we knew the shrink wrap was binding, wasn't possible. Nobody knew that the I accept could work. And also, there was no law yet that said the I accept would create a binding contract. All there was law about the physical act of tearing the shrink wrap off the box. So, you're the lawyer. What would you do in that instance? How would you devise a mechanism under which that license agreement would be binding on the consumer before they could view that kick-ass video from Megadeth?
If it's visible for the consumer, prudent consumer, right?
Okay. If it's visible and they somehow have a chance to read it,
yeah.
And then we'll figure out how they agree to it. Okay.
We can wipe on CD.
Yeah, you could wrap the CD, but of course, with the internet, the idea is immediate, widespread distribution, right? You don't want to have to mail a CD. so this, it's interesting, right? Let's make the license agreement visible to the consumer. So are you all practicing lawyers already? All practicing lawyers?
Yes.
And no law students? Okay, so, and who works in a law firm? Show of hands. Who works in-house? Okay, so particularly for the in-house people, tell me who that you work with is the person who thinks you're the biggest problem, right? Oh, I gotta go talk to a lawyer. What category of people?
The CEO.
The CEO, the boss, yeah. But to me, the CEO thinks that only because other people have told the CEO, right? You don't deal, maybe you deal with the CEO every day, but usually you're not dealing with the CEO every day. I'll tell you who the people who don't like you the most. They're the marketing people, right? The sales people. They want to sell, right? Right. They don't want contracts. Who needs contracts? I just want the money to come in,
yeah.
Right? So when we go to this concept of, well, we have to make sure that the consumer can see and read the license agreement, what do the marketing people say? No. I don't want them to see it. I want them to consume as fast as they can consume, right? So that was a conundrum we faced back in 1993. Sure, I could draft a license agreement easily, and I could make sure that the user, before they could click on that cool video, would see that and figure out some way to have them accept it. So now, with that idea, I can draft a license agreement, we want the consumer to see it and agree to it, and the marketing person is saying no, because that will impede my sales. Too many people will not bother to do that and then click on the content that I want them to click. What do? You have to innovate some more as a lawyer. So, what's your next step?
Find another market.
What's that? Find another marketing. Not possible, usually.
Yeah, I know. I'm tired of guys.
What do you do? Find another alternative to have them agree to that license agreement, right? So what is it? What is the alternative?
If you want to use it, the
online agreement.
Making them create the cards.
Wait, what did you say back then?
If you want to have it, click here. And if you want to
the online agreement.
Okay. But then, but now the record label that owns the video says, well, how do we know that's enforceable? It's 1993. Nobody's ever done that before. How do we know it's enforceable? And you're the lawyer. You look at the law, the Uniform Commercial Code or whatever, and you say, well, yeah, the law doesn't say it's enforceable. I think it should be, but the law doesn't say so. And the record label says, well, I want you, the lawyer, to tell me there's no way I'm jeopardizing my ownership of this content because I'm the music industry and I don't want anybody to see anything. Right, so we did come up with a solution. Give me, I want to get at least one more suggestion. How do you, without?
Automatically.
Yeah, automatically, but the law at the time did not say that was enforceable. So let's skip around to contracts for a second. The elements of a contract, right? Offer, acceptance, and consideration, okay? So how do you get to the point where you're confirming that the offer was made, you showed them the license, they accepted it? Mm-hmm. Consideration you have to worry about.
You can make three clicks. Do you accept this? Do you see this? Yes. Yes. Do you want to go on? Yes.
Right. Right, but then the marketing people will come back and say, ah,
we're borrowing client, too much burden.
And even today, I mean, you know, where we're all of us are so used to just clicking, I accept, I accept, I accept, I accept. We see a variety of different methods that lawyers have devised to ensure that that license agreement is enforceable, right? Sometimes it's just at the bottom of the website. If you want to see the terms, click here. But if you use the site, you're bound, right? And then there's a whole spectrum of additional things that a licensor might do to be able to more firmly say they saw it and they accepted it, right? The whole other end of the spectrum is not only is it there on the bottom of the site, but before you can access the content, it's forced. You must see it, right? You must scroll down to the bottom of it. You must click I accept, and you must put your initials, you know, actually type your name in the box. Why do they make you type your name in the box?
To know who's the customer.
Sure
that you
A kind of signature.
It's like a signature, but really the reason is you're already clicking I accept, but consumers could claim that wasn't me, that was my cat.
Exactly.
My cat jumped on the keyboard and clicked I accept.
So I was aware to make this.
Yeah. It's clear my cat, unless I have a very talented cat, did not type my initials in the box, right? So now, today we have this very, you know, a broad spectrum. And for those of you who have exposure to marketing people, the marketing people never want to do the, it has to pop up, they have to scroll down, they have to click, and they have to type their initials in. Only the most conservative licensors do that, like Adobe does that, Apple does that. But a lot of companies don't want to do that. I have, none of my clients want to do that. Right? They all want to have just, well, can I just have like a link at the bottom of the page, right? Because they want as few hurdles as possible for people to be consuming that content and paying them money. So what we did in 1993 was, remember, the law didn't really exist. We were trying to devise a way to argue the consumer knew the terms of the license and the consumer accepted. Therefore, offer, acceptance, consideration, binding contract. What we did was, I wrote the license, and then what's the other, so marketing people hate us, right? And what's the most common thing your client says when you hand them a contract? They're like, well, I want a license agreement for some software. Okay, right. You give it to the CEO, and what does the CEO say? Make it shorter.
Make it funner.
Right. Can it be more fun? Yeah, can it be shorter is usually...
Shorter.
Yeah, shorter.
Focus on 1, 2, 3 things.
Yes, right. Only what's important. I had a client, I had a long flight here, right? And on the flight, I just work. And I was corresponding with a client who said, you know, well, can't you just focus on what's important? And we have clients who say that all the time. And since I've been practicing law for 30 years, I have on my computer a whole group of standard emails, right? I've already typed them because I know clients are going to ask, can't you focus on what's important? Okay, they open the document, copy, paste. I can't focus on what's important because I can't predict the future. Here's a case about a $500 million comma. Here's a case, and I have the links to all these cases, right? So the CEO says, make it shorter, make it shorter, make it shorter. So I wrote this license for this music video. I showed it to the guy from was Capitol Records, and I said, well, this license will work, and I have a way I think we can prove offer acceptance and consideration. He said, make it shorter. I made it shorter. And then the method that we had devised was, okay, so there will be two video files. There'll be the music video, and then there'll be a much shorter video file that precedes the music video, which is the lead singer of the band reading the license agreement. So we had him on camera, and he read the license agreement, and we had him, I don't know if we had him do it or he just did it, but he read the license agreement with a lot of profanity in it. You know, because he's a rock star, right? So
must have been really, really short.
Yeah. It was short. It was short. But, I mean, you know, I won't use the profanity in this environment. We don't know each other well enough yet. But, you know, so he was saying, so this is how I make my effing living. This is my effing content. I created this. This is my dream. And I'm going to let you see it. And that's the coolest effing video you're ever going to see. But before you get it, you have to agree to these effing terms. You can't publicly display it.
Dude.
Yeah, and then he's like, you can't publicly display it. What the F does that mean? Anyway, you can't do this. You can't do that. And so we had him do this short video, and our theory was, well, look, there's no way the consumer is ever going to be able to claim they don't remember that, right? You'd have a, if anybody tried to manufacture copies of it, one of the five exclusive rights of the copyright owner, you could put that person on the witness stand and you could say, do you remember before you looked at that video, you saw Dave Mustaine, he was reading a license agreement and he said, you know, you can't effing make copies of it. It would be very hard for a consumer to say, well, I don't remember that. Yeah, you remember it. You saw that video and you still click to get the video itself. So we had a way to prove offer acceptance and consideration without a paper contract. And before I accept was a way to, a recognized way to create an enforceable contract. So, and that, I like that story a lot because it involves metal music, but also because it involves the marketing people saying, I don't want any impediments to people buying.
This was like marketing.
What's that?
This was something like marketing.
Yeah, right. Yeah, the video piece was marketing. Yeah. Right. It involved the CEO's charge, make it shorter. It involved the marketing people, I don't want to do anything. And we had to find a way to get the consumers to agree while also creating the contract that protected the ownership rights of the record company. All right, so that is kind of a tangent away from where were we? Who am I? That brings us all the way up to 1993. So I was in big law firms for over 10 years, then I just didn't want to do that anymore. Who works for a big law firm is kind of a relative term, right? Some firms are several thousand lawyers, and I don't know how big the firms are where you all practice, but by the standards of where you practice, who works for a big firm? Nobody? Who works for a small firm? Like fewer than 10 lawyers?
It's not
even
I
don't
know. Two people. All right, well, good.
We count for 10 for a big
firm. That's good. That's better than just one, right? Presumably, you make at least some money off that other lawyer, which is what we all want to do, right? Yeah. So, why were you. Yeah. So I worked for big law firms, and then, you know, has anybody ever, who's been to the United States? Okay, good. You know, the phrase corporate America, it's really a thing, right? Corporate America, and you all, we'll talk a little bit more about you, you know, in a minute, where you're from and what you do, and you all have your own version of corporate America, I'm sure. But, you know, corporate America is a thing, and it has its pros and it has its cons. I was in it for, you know, more than a dozen years or more than 10 years, and I didn't want to do it anymore. So I left big law firms and I became an entrepreneur. I joined at a very early stage and then helped to run a very early online streaming company. It was streaming, so that was probably 5 or 6 years after this video. Streaming by then existed. And I did that for a year and a half. We sold that company. Then I joined another early stage company. Again, didn't found it, but joined it at a very early stage, a video game company. Helped to run that for about 4 years. We sold that, and then I thought I would join another early stage company, but I wound up joining what is a New York Stock Exchange company, but it is professional wrestling. Who's familiar with professional wrestling? WWE. I like all the groans and oh yeah, I know what that is. Yeah. Are there any fans of WWE? Come on. Admit it.
Once upon a time.
Yeah, so.
When Hulk Hogan was wrestling.
Huh?
Yeah.
When Hulk Hogan, yeah. But that's their business model, right? So professional wrestling, they have a mantra. They say cradle to grave. That's how long they want you as a customer. And typically they have, it's actually almost half of the audience for professional wrestling is female, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah. But and that is a newer phenomenon. Historically, it was men, boys and men. And what they wanted to do was get you when you were, you know, like 5 years old as a fan. And then you would be a fan until you were maybe 13. And then you would realize that, I call it, you realize that Santa Claus doesn't exist, right? It's because when you're about 13 is when you learn that in professional wrestling, the outcomes are predetermined, right? I hate to break that to you. It's not fake, because when a guy's jumping off a 30-foot ladder, he's really jumping off a 30-foot ladder. It's dangerous, it's athletic, it's entertaining, but the outcomes are predetermined. And when a 13-year-old boy who's a fan learns that The Undertaker or Hulk Hogan, whatever, didn't really win that match, he was scripted to win it, they get disillusioned, and they move on to beer and marijuana. They what?
They move to UFC.
Yeah.
UFC. They move to UFC.
To UFC, yeah. No, but then what happens? So you're 13, you leave being a fan of WWE, but when you're 25 and you have your own little 5-year-old, then you come back, right? Because as a 25-year-old parent with a 5-year-old child, you're looking for ways to bond with that child, and you put WWE on, and the child's like, oh my God, Hulk Hogan. And then you, as the 25-year-old with the 5-year-old boy, you're a fan again until your children are grown, right? And that's WWE's business model. Get them in when they're 5, and then they're gonna go like this for the rest of their lives as a fan or not. Because then when you're a grandfather, you're gonna, or a grandmother, you're gonna take your grandchildren to see professional wrestling. So I worked for professional wrestling for 5 years, and one of the things I asked you to read was the press release for the most recent earnings, which we'll talk about that probably this afternoon. It's professional wrestling, right? So those of you who at least know what it is, you think it's just incredibly muscled people wearing almost nothing, covered in baby oil in the ring. But it's a New York Stock Exchange company. It's the market cap of WWE is more than $1 billion, right? And if you read the press release, they generate almost $1 billion a year in revenue. Huge, huge company. So after 4 years, even though it was a lot of fun, it always gave me something fun to talk about at cocktail parties. I didn't want to be on that corporate American treadmill anymore. I thought I had gotten off of it when I left Big Law. Somehow I wound up back on it. I left that again probably 8 or 9 years ago. And since 8 or 9 years ago, I've been doing a few things. I teach at Kent. I teach Chicago Kent in Chicago. I also teach business courses at an arts school in Chicago, an arts college, 9,000 students who want to be actors, singers, dancers, or business people in those industries. I have my own, I was a sole practitioner for 5 years, maybe 2 years ago. I joined a law firm again, 70 lawyers in 7 or 8 cities in the United States, where I do intellectual property licensing. Also, I'm sort of like an outside general counsel, so I do a lot of things, commercial transactions, mergers and acquisitions. I own a restaurant, so before we leave here, we can all like the Facebook page. It's in Chicago, yeah. It's in Evanston, which is...
So probably if you come there, you will get a discount if you like.
Let me tell you something. So I've been teaching for School of American Law now for 6 years, once or twice a year, do 2 cities. So this weekend I'm in Athens, next weekend I'll be in Tbilisi. And this is kind of a large class for School of American Law, but on the larger side. Every time, and we're already getting to know each other. By the end of tomorrow, we're really going to know each other. We'll be friends. Or enemies. I will tell you all right now, if you come to Chicago, who's thinking about going to Chicago Kent to get the LLM? Okay. And some of you will, I hope you all do. When you come, please call me. We'll go to my restaurant. We'll have a meal. You know how many people over 6 years, have ever done that? Like 3.
Oh.
That's it. I don't know, because it's weird, right?
They get lost in Chicago.
They get lost, but also they're like, well, he seemed like a nice guy, but was that just show? Should I call the guy? I don't know. You should.
Maybe that's not the way it's
people. We're getting about some and go beer and marijuana there.
Yeah, right. But you should. We should get together if you come to Chicago, especially if you haven't been to Chicago before. I'll take you to my restaurant, and then I'll take you for Chicago pizza or ribs or something like that. Fantastic food in Chicago.
So our restaurant is the best
get the
part
ticket for the next month.
Work of being tired and vices.
Right.
That's right.
Relax. Yeah.
And
work and play.
Enjoy.
Yes. Actually, of the 3, it is only 3 in the whole history have ever gone out for a meal with me. Sometimes people email or, hey, I'm in Chicago, hi. Okay, hi. You can email me from Athens, but...
maybe they are too shy people, you know?
Maybe, right, and it's a weird dynamic.
I'm very shy.
Even though we're all professionals here, it's a weird dynamic between student and professor, like we shouldn't cross that line, but we should.
That's true.
But of the 3 people, 2 of them were from my class in Athens last time I was here. So that's good. And one of the people from the class in Athens, I think I've had dinner with 3 people from School of American Law in Chicago. I've had coffee with 2. One of the coffee people was also from Athens. So people who are in this class are typically more friendly. More willing to cross that imaginary line. Anyway, so.
We're going
to
have a big table.
Big table.
It's going to be an issue.
All right.
I'm going to be an issue.
We can do that.
Especially if we are going to be happy after the exam.
Of course, we have to have an exam because that's school. But, I'm far more interested in the conversations that we're going to have today and tomorrow than I am in that exam.
Absolutely.
All right, so, so that's me. And then let me just remind myself where I am today. Oh, okay, so we were talking about this. So now, I had asked you to read one of these licenses. Nobody had raised their hand like, oh yeah, I've looked at one of those on my own. I read them on my own because I teach in this area, and also because I just want to sort of look at them. The Facebook one that I had asked you to read coming into the class is actually one that they had been using for a couple of years up to late last year. So what happened in Facebook late last year, or actually, investigation about?
About personal data, right?
And so when you sign that contract with anyone, part of it is about personal data, right? It's not only a license of the intellectual property rights, but also about personal data. And they had a big scandal and investigation about people's personal data. So the this agreement that you were asked to read is something like, how many pages is it? Like five or seven?
Seven, eight pages.
In preparation, I also teach this class in a semester-long version back in the United States, and in preparation for a class session there, which we won't do here because we just don't have enough time in the weekend, I always go and I get the most recent version of that Facebook license so I can have the most recent one to talk about in class. And I spent 3 hours on the Facebook site trying to find the entirety of that license agreement. So here's another thing about lawyers, right? The marketing people hate us. Everything always has to be shorter. But what's a valid criticism of us? If you give me an unlimited space to write, I'll write forever, right?
Yes.
And so that's what happens with these online agreements. It used to be a shrink wrap piece of paper on the back of the box. You only have 8.5 by 11, okay? And as lawyers, that was fine for us because what we're always worried about is getting sued for malpractice. The reason the contracts get longer and longer and longer is because we don't want to get sued. We want to put everything in there, minimize all possible risk. Also, we like to talk, right? But if you give us an unlimited amount of room to write, we're going to write forever. But if you tell me, I'm hiring you to do this license agreement, you only have 8.5 by 11. Okay, but I have then somewhat of a defense to the malpractice claim because I couldn't put everything in. I could only put in what fit on 8.5 by 11. But today, they get longer and longer and longer. So to my point, they had the investigation at Facebook and they told the lawyers, we don't ever want this to happen again. So what did the lawyers do? Write, 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 write. And so I spent 3 hours on the Facebook page. And what's the another phenomenon about these online agreements in today's world is you're reading some text and then, well, if you want to know about this other thing, click here. Yeah. And then you read what's at that page and one paragraph in. Well, if you want to know about this little detail, click here. And you just, it's like a little maze.
Yeah, yeah.
So if you tried today to go to the Facebook terms and conditions like I did, you would spend at least 3 hours and not finish. I couldn't finish. I'm a very detail-oriented, obsessive compulsive person. So I was able to keep records like, okay, I'm on page 3, I'm in the second paragraph, I'm clicking on that link to see what's next. Well, I would write it down. Okay, page 3, second paragraph. I'd go down that little rat hole, then I'd come back. And I read a little bit more, then I go down that rat hole, then come back. And I did that for 3 hours, I could not finish. That's how much the lawyers have tried to protect Facebook in the wake of that scandal. But let's talk about the license agreement for Facebook that you have. Did I ask you to read the Facebook and the YouTube one, or just the Facebook? Was it just one or two? You're the one who did the work. Okay, so the Facebook one, okay, so that is the new terms of service.
Yeah, this is the new.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so that's the one that if you were to click on it, you wouldn't be able to finish in 3 hours. But let's just for the sake of a little bit of discussion, before we take our first break today, let's look at, or we don't have to look at, let me just tell you what's in the old version of the Facebook license, the one that is of somewhat manageable size. Okay. First of all, I mean, a point I want to make about it is it was drafted in January of 2015, and this license agreement that I'm looking at that you don't have access to was in place for about 3 years until the scandal happened and they decided to make it this much longer agreement. So it was the case that these online agreements for bigger companies like Facebook and Google and YouTube had become somewhat stable, right? This one hadn't changed for 3 years. So in the relationship with Facebook, it's a dual relationship, right? You're getting content from Facebook, and you're also giving content to Facebook, right? When I look at your photos, I'm consuming your content, but when I upload my photos, I'm disseminating my content. So what the Facebook license said was, when you upload some content to Facebook, you grant a non-exclusive, transferable, sub-licensable, royalty-free, worldwide license to use any IP content that you post. Okay. Interestingly, a couple years before this, Facebook used to have a contract that said when you upload, you transfer ownership to Facebook. And then somebody read this, and there was a public backlash in the United States. And Facebook changed to, okay, we don't own it, but you give us all these rights, correct? And they have also said, this IP license ends when you delete your IP content. So it used to be the case that you transferred ownership. Then they changed it to, okay, you don't transfer ownership, but you license it to us forever. And then there was another public backlash, and they changed the license again to say, okay, you license it to us until you delete it. And then that license expires. But during the term of that license, it is pretty broad, right? It's not exclusive, but it's transferable, it's sub-licensable, royalty-free, worldwide, blah, 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 right? Another thing that you'll find in almost all licenses in the United States, including online click-to-accept licenses, is the choice of venue clause, and that's no exception in the Facebook license. If you have a dispute with Facebook, you agree that the dispute will be in San Mateo County, California, right? And why do they want the venue in San Mateo County, California?
Under the state laws of California?
Court friendly.
Actually, it's interesting because California is, of the U.S. states, it's one of the most liberal, right? Consumer friendly. Friendly to people, not businesses. So that, having it in San Mateo County, anywhere in California, is to Facebook's detriment in that regard. Because the law, all laws are very favorable to people, not businesses in California. So that would be bad for them, but they still want it there anyway. Why do they want it there?
Good PR.
Good PR? If there's a lawsuit, they want it there?
Yeah. They might win it. They might have more revenues. They might gain customer.
They have their headquarters there.
What's that?
They have their headquarters there.
Well, their headquarters are there, why is that good to have the litigation there also?
Easier for them.
It's easier and cheaper.
Yeah.
They have they have hundreds of lawyers right at the Facebook headquarters, so they probably would hire outside lawyers for a lawsuit, but still, all the lawyers that work there, many of the lawyers that work there work right in San Mateo County. The executives are there. To the extent to which they have to go testify, it's cheaper, etc. What's another reason they want it in that venue?
Court friendly?
court friendly. And it, whether it's the judge or the jury, right? Facebook brings a lot of revenue to San Mateo County. They do a lot of PR. People love Facebook and hate Facebook, right, who live in the neighborhood around the Facebook headquarters. But by and large, people know, hey, those new roads, you know, that new park, that was Facebook money, right? And so if Facebook is in a dispute with a consumer from Athens, and the consumer from Athens has to go to California and litigate, and they're in front of a jury, regardless of who's right or who's wrong, Facebook has an advantage because they're the more known quantity, the favorite son, as it were.
They feel protected there.
What's that?
Feels protected there.
Yes.
It's their home.
It's their home.
Yeah.
And they're, you might have a phrase for this in your own language, but you know the we have a word for this in America. If Facebook wants to hometown you, or if you're the defendant or the person in the litigation with Facebook, you're afraid of getting hometowned, right?
Of
because
course.
It's Facebook's hometown. I don't want to get hometowned, is, you know, kind of the colloquial way you would phrase it. So they put it in San Mateo County for that reason, for those reasons. It's more than one reason. Interestingly, from an international perspective, because we're here in Athens today, the Facebook terms and conditions, even before the scandal, now the way the current terms speak to international users is almost like there's a different terms and conditions for every territory. But even 3 years ago, before it got crazy, there was in this 7-page license, certain specific terms that apply only to German users are available here. It's another link, but they were concerned enough at that point about Europe and in particular Germany that they had a whole separate click out to that, to terms for just German users. And then finally, even back in the day, while they had this relatively short agreement, I did go through and I counted it. There were 28 hyperlinks out to additional terms and conditions. Right. How do you deal with that as a lawyer? Who's had a client come to you and say, "I have a contract, or I want to enter into a deal with somebody. They've given me their online contract. They just want me to, go online and click. Can you look at it?" How do you address that with your client if it contains hyperlinks in it? What do you say? What do you do?
We spend time.
So click through and click through.
And take the most important part for depending on the reason of the contract.
Okay.
On the object of the contract.
Okay.
Focusing on that.
Pay me by hyperlink.
Pay me by link, yeah. Well, I think that's a good point because oftentimes the clients, they don't look either. They just send it to you. Is this okay? You know, which is frustrating for us as lawyers, right? Because when the clients do that, even if it's a paper contract, we don't even know if, like, it says $1 million, the price is $1 million. I don't even know if that's right? Because you haven't told me what the deal is. You just sent me a contract and said this is okay. But in the online context, they don't look at the link. They just want you, they want to shift the risk to you, right? They don't, you know, if you say it's okay, then, and it's not, then it's on you, not them, right? So, And clients don't typically realize that there are all these hyperlinks. So at the very least, to your point, pay me by link, I will go through contracts like that and I will either do it myself or have an assistant do it where I say, okay, click on every link and print the page, save it all to a PDF, right? And then at least we can count the pages. And I can tell my client, well, this contract is really 432 pages. I'm a pretty fast reader, but even at 6 minutes a page, you can do the math, you know, it's gonna take me 42 hours or whatever to read this thing. Do you really want me to read it? Mm-hmm. And that's a problem, you know, in today's world for lawyers whose clients just wanna do business, right?
The time.
Well, yeah, and you know, and clients who want our advice, but not really. They want our advice, but also what they want to do is shift the risk to us, right? And we can't allow that as lawyers. All right, so we've been talking for about an hour. I know we've got to change the batteries in the camera for your classmates who didn't do you the courtesy of coming today. Christina also made me promise to let you guys take a break. So why don't we take a break for, 5 or 10 minutes, and then we'll come back.